right, hello everyone. It's me. I'm back. I'm sorry it's been a little while since I've uploaded. I thought I would be able to balance making YouTube videos with schoolwork, but this past semester that was not the case. Hopefully next semester it will be. But now I'm on summer break, which means I have tons of time to film and edit videos, and I'm really excited for it, and I hope you are too. So, let's get into it. The topic for today's video is terraforming, which is defined as the process of transforming a planet to make it resemble Earth, specifically so that it will be able to support human life. Now, it doesn't have to be a planet. You could terraform a moon or an asteroid, but most people who are interested in terraforming focus on Mars, so that's what I'll be focusing on in this video. Now, terraforming is a long and complex process that has never been attempted, except in science fiction. Perhaps the most notable example is Kim Stanley Robinson's Red Mars trilogy. And although I've only read the first book, I do definitely recommend it. Before we can get into the mechanics of how someone could terraform, let's consider the motive. The question of why we would terraform Mars is a complicated one, and depends on who you ask. But the most common answer, espoused by people like Elon Musk, is that terraforming Mars allows us to have a backup planet in case some big disaster makes Earth uninhabitable. That disaster could be a nuclear war, it could be an asteroid impact, but the most realistic near-future disaster is total ecological collapse caused by climate change. Now, at first glance, the idea of making another habitable planet sounds completely reasonable. But in this video, I'd like to lay out just how difficult terraforming really is, and argue that the idea that we have some backup Earth can actually have dangerous implications. Now, we'll talk about how to terraform Mars. We can understand terraforming as the process of taking specific features of Mars and transforming them to be more like features of Earth. So, to explain how terraforming could be achieved, I'll briefly examine each of these six Martian traits. Let's start with the traits that we cannot change, no matter how hard we try. The first is Mars's low gravity. Mars is about 1/6 the size of Earth, and also significantly less dense, which means that gravity on Mars is only 38% of what it is here. So, on Mars, I would only weigh 50 pounds, about as much as a bull terrier. Now, low gravity is something that the colonists will have to deal with, as we can't really change the mass of Mars. I mean, we could hypothetically smash a bunch of asteroids into the Martian surface, but that would probably only change Mars's overall mass by 0.1% at most. So, low gravity is something that Martian colonists would be stuck with, and that could actually be a significant problem. Studies have linked long-time exposure to low gravity with numerous health problems, most notably weakened bone structure. These problems would be particularly severe in any babies born on Mars who may never develop healthy skeletons. So, since we can't change Mars's mass, we'll have to find a medical way to deal with these problems for a colony to ever succeed. The next feature of Mars that we cannot change is its lengthy calendar. A Martian year is 687 days long, which is almost twice as long as an Earth year. The only way to shorten that would be to somehow move Mars closer to the Sun, which I don't think will be in our technical capacity anytime soon. Because of the longer year, Mars also has much longer seasons than Earth, which could affect the types of plants that will be able to grow there, since many plants have evolved to survive in Earth's four shorter seasons. But we can overcome that by growing crops in a closed greenhouse environment with simulated Earth conditions. In addition to the longer year, Mars also has a slightly longer day than Earth at 24 hours and 37 minutes. Now, at first I thought that doesn't sound so bad. Colonists should be able to adjust to having a few extra minutes every day. But then someone from NASA responded to me on Reddit and informed me that since humans have evolved to live in a 24-hour cycle, those extra minutes could have significant effects on clock-controlled biological processes. This is yet another issue with Mars that we won't be able to change. But still, wouldn't it be kind of cool to have an extra 37 minutes every day? I'd probably waste them looking at Doge memes or something. Let me know in the comments how you would spend those extra minutes every day. So, we've discussed the qualities of Mars that we cannot change. namely the low gravity and long calendar. So let's move on to discussing the traits of Mars that we can change. And I won't spend too much time on any individual one of these, because you'll notice that they're all very interrelated. Let's begin with Mars's barren soil. Martian soil is primarily regolith, which basically means that it's a layer of dust and broken pieces of rock. This is why dust storms are so common on Mars, like the one that killed the Opportunity rover. Furthermore, Martian soil is full of perchlorate chemicals, which are toxic to both plants and humans. However, NASA reports that in some regions of Mars, the soil actually does have the necessary nutrients to grow plants. Additionally, a recent study at Villanova recreated Martian soil and found that some plants actually grow quite well in it, including kale, lettuce, and sweet potatoes. Also, those perchlorate chemicals that I mentioned sound scary, but they actually dissolve in water. So, once we have water on Mars, we should be able to rinse them right out. But that, of course, brings us to our next big problem, water. Contrary to what many believe, Mars does not lack water. It actually has a great deal of water. In fact, many scientists believe that Mars used to be covered in an ocean that looked something like this. The problem, however, is that most of the water on Mars now is frozen. Mars's northern ice cap is mostly ice water, while its southern ice cap contains frozen water as well, trapped under a layer of frozen CO2. In fact, there is enough frozen water on Mars's surface to cover the entire planet in an ocean 100 feet deep. And there's probably even more ice water trapped under the surface. Utilizing the water that's already on Mars is essential, because any spacecraft coming from Earth won't be able to bring along enough water to support an entire colony. Why? Well, it costs about $1,000 to get a single pound of material into space, using SpaceX's most efficient rockets. Now, this is way better than the $10,000 it costed a decade ago, and SpaceX does want to get this figure even lower. But as it stands, it costs about $8,000 to get a single gallon of water into space. Not to mention the fact that rockets need to be light enough to get off the ground in the first place, so we can't just fill them with water. So, any successful colony would need to utilize the water that's already present on Mars. This leads us to ask, how can we turn Mars's frozen ice caps back into a liquid ocean, like the one displayed in this image from SpaceX's website? Well, this leads us to our next feature of Mars, its low temperature. The temperature on Mars can vary pretty greatly. If we set up a colony close to the equator, then, during the Martian summer, temperatures could reach a pleasant 70 degrees Fahrenheit during the day. But at night, that temperature could drop to negative 100 Fahrenheit. For reference, the coldest inhabited city on Earth is Omyakon, Russia, where temperatures are often below negative 80 Fahrenheit, so negative 100 is technically livable if you bundle up enough. But for most of the year, temperatures will be well below negative 100, especially if we set up a colony closer to the poles, which, as mentioned, would probably be the main source of water. The temperature at the poles is consistently well below negative 200 Fahrenheit, which is why the water there is permanently trapped in ice. Now, Mars is cold for two reasons. One, it's about 50% further from the Sun than the Earth, which, again, is not something we can change. Second, and more importantly, Mars has an incredibly thin atmosphere which is incapable of trapping in heat. So, this leads us to our sixth and final feature of Mars, its thin atmosphere. As you can probably tell by now, Mars's atmosphere, or lack thereof, is basically the root of all its problems. If we want usable soil, then we need liquid water. And if we want liquid water, then we need higher temperatures. And if we want higher temperatures, then we need an atmosphere capable of trapping in heat. Also, if we ever want to be able to breathe on Mars, then we'll need an atmosphere for that too. And finally, something that I haven't mentioned yet is radiation. Mars has dangerously high levels of radiation, partly because it doesn't have an atmosphere capable of blocking cosmic and solar rays. Now, to really understand the differences between the atmospheres of Earth and Mars, I'm going to do a little demonstration. So, Earth has a relatively thick atmosphere made up of 78% nitrogen, in addition to 21% oxygen, which is what we need to breathe. Now, Mars, on the other hand, has an atmosphere made up almost entirely of carbon dioxide. And not only that, but the atmosphere that it does have is over 100 times thinner than ours. So what does this mean? Well, when the sun gives off its light and it reaches Earth, most of it gets trapped in by our atmosphere, which causes our planet to be heated. At the same time, our atmosphere is pretty good at blocking us from the sun's harmful rays. Now, Mars, on the other hand, when it's hit by the sun's light, is unable to trap it in because it has such a thick, has such a thin atmosphere, which means that it's very cold, and its atmosphere isn't able to block the sun's harmful rays, which causes its surface to have high levels of radiation. So the question is, how do we turn this into this? And the answer is that we can't. Now, to be more specific, we could, but it would take hundreds of years and probably trillions of dollars. YouTube channel SciShow has a great video describing the ways we could hypothetically give Mars an Earth-like atmosphere, and I recommend you check it out, link in the description. What you should notice is that every proposal they mention is incredibly difficult, expensive, and time-consuming. One idea they give is to put factories on Mars that can convert its mineral resources into greenhouse gases. But think about how many factories we would need, as well as how many expensive rocket trips it would take to get all the necessary materials to Mars. They also mentioned putting a 200-kilometer mirror in orbit around Mars that would concentrate sunlight towards its south pole, melting it, releasing carbon dioxide. And that actually sounded pretty reasonable, until I remembered how big 200 kilometers really is. They even talk about attaching rockets to asteroids and crashing them into Mars, which I had mentioned earlier in this video as a joke. And yeah, maybe one day in the future, that will be a possibility. Maybe the space mirror will be a possibility, maybe the factories will be a possibility. But the fact is, even if we could give Mars an Earth-like atmosphere, it has no way to hold on to it. Unlike Earth, Mars lacks a magnetosphere, which is basically a magnetic field that blocks a planet from radiation and prevents its atmosphere from being pushed out into space by solar winds. Without a magnetosphere, any efforts to give Mars an atmosphere would be pointless, as it would just drift out into space. And yes, there are some ideas on how we could give Mars a magnetosphere, but they're even more complicated and far-fetched, because we would probably need to convert Mars's solid core into liquid metal. So look, I'm not saying terraforming is impossible, I'm just saying it's really, really difficult. And maybe you're someone who likes the challenge. But besides the difficulty, there are other valid reasons why we should avoid terraforming Mars. The first is sort of an aesthetic argument. When I see this image, I see a beautiful planet that has been untouched for 4 billion years. Now, to me, the idea that humans can go and just change it all at once sounds kind of selfish. But maybe you think, who cares? It's just rocks. And that's fine. But maybe you'd be more convinced if I told you that terraforming Mars could prevent us from ever knowing if we're alone in the universe. Now, to this day, there has been no evidence of life on Mars. But some scientists believe that bacterial life could be dwelling deep below the Martian surface. If we went and completely terraformed Mars, we might kill that life, or at the very least, contaminate it so much that we might never know that it originated on Mars. To me, this would be a true tragedy, as there's so much we can learn from observing an alien life form, even just a bacteria. So look, I used to be in favor of terraforming. I thought it sounded like an awesome project, and I even wanted to be involved with it one day. But then I did the research, and I realized how difficult it would be, as well as the other arguments that I just mentioned, and my opinion changed. Now, I am still very in favor of humans building a settlement on Mars. I think there are so many scientific and political reasons why that would be awesome. But I think we can do that without having to transform the entire planet. So nowadays, when I hear people like Elon Musk talking about terraforming like it's our salvation, without being upfront about how difficult it really is, I think they're giving us a false sense of hope. They're letting people believe that we have a backup planet, when in reality, we only have one. For the foreseeable future, Earth is our only home. We can't just go around acting like if we break this planet, we can move on to the next. If we break this planet, we're dead. So, the next time you hear someone talking about terraforming, at the very least, take it with a grain of salt. And always keep in mind that Earth is our home. Our only home.